Hello and welcome back to Datacast. We're going to use R to download files from the web today. Let's start by opening R Studio, and you can see here I've started a new R script file. I'm going to save this and I'm going to call it download_files. And you can see here that I am going to repeat the command that we used in our previous video, install load packages tidyverse. So what's actually going on with this code? Well, install.packages is what we call a function, and R has loads of these, sometimes via the packages we install and sometimes without them, which we call base R. A function accepts arguments, and in this case, the argument is tidyverse in quotation marks. So we're calling the install.packages function, which installs packages, and we're passing the tidyverse argument to that function. And that tells this function to specifically install the tidyverse package. Of course, I also need to load that package, so let's go ahead and add library tidyverse. You can probably guess that library is also a function. Now, there's no way you'll remember all of the functions available in R and what they do, but here's one of the reasons why RStudio is so helpful. Just type the name of the function, and we're going to do this down here in the console. So just type the name of the function, install.packages, and then if we put a question mark in front of that and hit enter, and you can see here on the right-hand side, we get loads of information about that function. So this describes what the function does. It tells us the different arguments that it accepts and explains those arguments for us. And if we scroll down, we get more details if there's something that we need to be aware of in using this function. And then right at the bottom, we actually get an example, sometimes several examples, of how this particular function is used. And other functions that might be of interest to us that might be related to this function in some way. Now, R is all about working with data, but we don't have any data yet. So where do we get it from? Well, data is everywhere, of course, and comes in a variety of different formats. Today, we're going to grab a more unusual data type called RDF, because I want to access data about new books published in the UK, and this is how the British Library provides that data. You can see a list of these files on their British National Bibliography website, which is on the British Library website. It's also known as the BNB. And the RDF files we want are beneath these PDF files. And we're not going to use PDF files because they aren't very convenient when we're trying to extract data. So if I scroll down to the RDF files, which are down here, now you can see that the file format here is actually a .zip rather than a .rdf. And in a later video, I'll show you how to extract the .rdf file from within that zip folder. And again, using R. Now let's come back to RStudio. If I told you that there is a function to download files from the web, can you guess what that function is called? If you guessed download.file, then well done. Now again, I can type this down here, download dot. And you can see that RStudio is trying to actually finish this line for me. It thinks it knows what I'm trying to write here. I can just hit enter and that will complete the line. I can put a question mark in front of there and then run this line of code. So to do that, I just go to the end of the line and do command and enter on my Mac. And it runs that code, and then lo and behold, on the bottom right, I get this help screen about the download.file function. So the first argument, URL, this is a character string, name and the URL of a resource to be downloaded. This will actually be a list of URLs in our case, which it does also accept. The second argument, dest file, this is a character string with a name where the downloaded file is saved. So effectively, this is where I'm downloading the files to on my own local machine. Including, crucially, the name of the saved file. And then the other argument that we're interested in is method, which is the method used for downloading the files. I'm actually going to be using libcurl, and if we scroll down a bit further, it says here that when libcurl is used, it says that there is support for simultaneous downloads. And that's something I'm interested in because I do intend to grab multiple files at once, so we will use the libcurl method here. Right, so before we can actually go ahead and use this download.file function, we need a list of URLs from which we can download several RDF files at once. Now, to do that, I'm going to create a vector. And I create that vector by passing arguments to C. Now again, if we pop a question mark in front of this and have a look at the help file down here, I can learn more about what this actually does. Now a vector is a bit more complicated than just a list of stuff, but for now we can simply understand it as a list of stuff. Okay, so what I want to do is paste in the URLs for three of these RDF files. So if I go back to this British Library webpage, I'm just going to copy the link location here, and then we place this within quotation marks because it's treated as a string, and strings are within quotation marks, and we separate each of our items here with a comma. So there we go, we have links, URLs here for three of these RDF files stored as a vector. Now I want to refer to this vector when I call download file, so we'll need to assign it to a variable. Now a variable is just a quick way of referencing something without having to write the whole thing out again, and we create it by writing the variable name. So I'm going to call this one target underscore URLs, and this is followed by a sort of like an arrow that points backwards. You see you've got this kind of backwards pointing arrow followed by a hyphen. It's a bit like saying target URLs equals a vector of URLs. Now, one more thing before we call download.files, I also need a way of pointing directly to the file that I'm going to download so that I can save it to my computer using that same file name. Now, let's create another variable here, and I'm going to call it target underscore files. Now, what I'm assigning to that variable name is another function, and it's called BaseName. Now, I can already see through this little pop-up that RStudio is telling me that it accepts one argument, which is a path. Now if I come down to the console and again just type this in with the question mark in front, it tells me the base name removes all of the path up to and including the last path separator, if any, and that the path argument is a character vector containing path names. So this is exactly what I want. And path name, you might think that the path name I pass in here is target URLs, which is the list of URLs that we created earlier, because we're trying to get the file name from each of these URLs, but that's only partly correct. Now you see, if I look at one of these URLs, so if I look at this first one here, the quite long URLs, now the file name is actually here, bnbrdf_n3621.zip. But then I have sort of all this extra stuff. It's telling me that the language is English, and then it has this unique hash value, which is added to each of these files. Now if I come down here to the console and I type in base name, and then what I'm going to do is just paste in one of these URLs into base name in the console. Nothing is going to be saved here because I'm not assigning this to a variable. I'm just pasting it into the console to see what happens. Now you can see it does remove everything prior to the file name, but it also returns everything after the file name. So I need some way of removing this part of what has been returned from base name. Now this is where we'll get our first glimpse of tidyverse notation. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to feed in target URLs into base name, which gets us what we saw down here. Then I'm going to pipe that output into another function. And that's what this symbol is here. This is a pipe which comes to us via the tidyverse. And you can use Command-Shift-M on your keyboard as a shortcut on the Mac to get this. It effectively says, whatever this returns, grab it and pipe it into this next thing, which is going to be another function. Now this next function is a tidyverse-specific function, and if I wanted to look at the help file for that, I actually need to load up tidyverse. I haven't actually run any code other than what we're doing down here in the console. So I'm just going to go ahead and highlight these top two lines where I install and load up tidyverse, and I'm going to hit Command and Enter. So you can see it's installing tidyverse if I don't already have it installed, and then it loads tidyverse and it tells me all the different packages that are coming in from tidyverse here. So that's useful stuff to know. I can see all the packages I've got, I can see which versions of the packages and whether there are any conflicts. Great, so now I have full access to tidyverse. So now if I start typing the name of a function that I know is within tidyverse, is actually in the str package, str underscore, and it's actually replace that I want, which is down here. Now if I just hit F1 here to have a look at the help function for this. So I can see that strreplace accepts a string, a pattern, and a replacement. If I scroll down to look at the examples, I can see in this top example, they've created a vector, we know how to do that, called fruits, with these three items, one apple, two pears, three bananas. And then it's feeding that into the first argument for strreplace. That's the list of strings it's looking at. And then the pattern it's searching for is A-E-I-O-U, and then it's going to replace that with a hyphen. Okay, so let's finish off typing this in, strreplace. Now, I've already pulled in the first argument, the string, because it's been piped in from the baseName function. So whatever comes out of the baseName function is going to be the first argument in strreplace. So next, I need to look at the pattern. Now, I don't know what the hash value will be, so I need something quite dynamic here, and that's where regular expressions or regex can help. I'm not going to go into the intricacies of regex here, but maybe I'll cover it in a future video. I'll also leave some links down in the description box if you're interested in learning more about this. Anyway, here's the pattern I'm going to use. It's going to be within quotation marks. So there's our pattern, and I want to replace that with essentially nothing. So I'll just do an open and close quotation marks here. Okay, so with these two variables in place, target URLs and target files, we can now pass them as arguments to download.file, which we have down here. So we pass target URLs as our first argument. This is just the list of URLs we'll be downloading our files from. We know we can use the original names of these files to save them locally. So dest file, which is the second argument, is going to be equal to target underscore files. And finally, we know that the method that we're using, this is the one we looked at earlier, is libcurl. Okay, that was a lengthy explanation for three lines of code, but now let's run this and see what happens. I've already run the top two lines here when I installed tidyverse and loaded the library. I'm just going to highlight everything else, and then I'm going to hit command and enter. Now you can see down on the console, it's keeping me up to date with what's going on, it's trying these URLs. Now if I come over here and look into my working directory, I can see here are these three files that have been downloaded, and they're using the file names taken from the source, which is exactly what I wanted. Brilliant. So now you know how to download files from the web using R. We've also looked at functions and how we can learn more about them, how to create vectors and variables, and how to use tidyverse functions to parse strings. Good job. We've learned a lot today, so let's take a breather and come back to this again in the next video.